लाइक शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब एंड प्रेस द बेल आइकन। Hello everyone, so in the previous video we have started with the chapter water. We have learnt various aspects of water, various usefulness of water, then various physical properties of water such as the enormous expansion, latent heat of fusion, latent heat of vaporization. All these physical properties we have started in the previous video. At the same time we have also learnt that water is a universal solvent, that is water is capable to dissolve a large number of substances into it, which those substances they may be in the solid state, liquid state or in the gaseous state. That is water is capable of forming a large number of solutions. So today we'll be discussing about solutions. Now first of all, this is something which is very common, which we all of us know, that is solute. What is a solution? So what do we mean by solutions? That is solute plus solvent, it give rise to the formation of a substance which is called as the solution. That's very simple. But today we'll be learning this in depth about the solution. So what is a solution? Suppose if you are taking a beaker over here, let me give you an example. Suppose if this is a beaker over here and into this there is water and we add some, so here it is containing some water over here into the beaker, and we are adding some, again you put some crystals of sugar into it. Let me represent with the red pen over here. So you are putting some crystals of sugar into it, okay, and you stir it. Will find that the sugar crystals after some time they will not be seen separately, so these are the sugar crystals, okay, and you will not be able to see the sugar crystal separately after some time. So this resultant substance which has been formed, this is called as the solution. It is a solution of what? Sugar solution over here. So from here we get an idea over here, what is a solvent? That is a medium which is capable of dissolving. So the medium of dissolution, when we talk about the solution, we should be able to say which one is called as the solvent, which one is called as the solute. So medium of dissolution, medium of dissolution, that is called as the solvent, and the substance which dissolves into this medium, that is called as the solute. So we should be capable of finding out which one is the solvent. Suppose if a solution has been given to you and you have been mentioned that this is a particular solution, you should be capable of identifying, that is which one is acting as a solute and which one is acting as a solvent. So suppose if you are having a solution in such a way where one of the the substances are in different phases, as I have given the example of this particular solution over here, where water is in the liquid phase or water is in the liquid state, we represent it by L over here, and sugar is in the solid state. Okay, so when the two components are in such way that the physical states of the components, that is the physical state of the solute of the substances are different, that is one of them is in the liquid state, the other is in the solid state. So how will we represent, that is which one is the solute, which one is the solvent over here? So we'll look out for the phase of this resultant component or this solution which has been formed. What is the state of this component? This is also liquid. So here from these two substances, the one which is having the same phase is that of the solution. That means water is in the, or we can say the one which is having the same physical state as that of the solution, that will be called as the solvent, and the other component will be called as the solute. So water is in the liquid state and the solution which has been formed, that is also in the liquid state. So there these states both are same. So obviously this one, that is water, will be called over here as the solvent, and the other substance, the other component, that is sugar which has been present over here, that will be called as the solute. So here we write down, this is acting as a solvent, and this sugar which is present over here, this is acting as a solute. So it becomes easy to identify over here which one is, that is this way of identification is easy. other way also, suppose if the component, if two components are there and they are in different, present in different proportions, so the one which is present in large proportion, that will be called as the solvent and the other will be called as the solute. Now here, this was one way of finding out which one is solute and the solvent. So, and here the other way also, there's a, that is, water is present in large excess, so obviously the water will be called as the solvent. And the other component, that is sugar, is present in small quantity, so that will be called as the solute. Okay. Now suppose if both the components here, if the states were different, so it was easy for us to find out. But in the case where the states of the substances are same, that is the two components, that is, are existing in the same phase, then how would we find out which one is the solute and which one is the solvent? So what we do, first let me give an example. Suppose if you are having let us take an example of a solution, that is water plus alcohol. Water plus alcohol, that is also a solution. So here both are in the liquid state. This is in the liquid state. I am representing it with L. This is also in the liquid state. Now which one is in large excess? Obviously water, whenever alcohol is mixed, water is taken in more quantity. So this one will be acting as a solvent because this is in large quantity. And this is in less quantity, so this will be acting as a solute. So this is the second way of identifying, that is, the substance which will be present in large quantity, that will be called as the solvent, and the other, the one which is, will be present in small quantity, that will be called as the solute. Let us take another example, that is, suppose if you are having, this is a liquid solution. Liquid solution. Now solution always does not mean that the substances should be in the liquid state. Something, the resultant substance should always be in the liquid state. There are also solid solutions. Solid solutions. Now in solid solutions, both the solute as well as the solvent, both of them, they will be in the solid state. Let us take the example of the solid solutions. Suppose if you take 70% copper plus if 30% zinc, then the resultant component, we get a solid solution, and that is given the particular name, that is as a brass. Brass is a type of an alloy. Brass is an alloy. So alloys are the examples of the solid solutions where the components are taken into the solid state. So here copper is present. Which component is present in the large excess? Obviously copper is in the large excess. Copper is present in more quantity, that is 70%, and zinc is present only in 30%. So obviously this will be called as the solvent and this is called as the solute. Clear? So I hope from these examples it becomes easier for you to find out which one is the solvent and which one is the solute. So these are the two ways of finding out the solute as well as the solvent. Now when we study about this chapter, we'll just need to go through all these terms, because these are the terms which we come across very often. So let us just proceed further, and also here the true solution. Okay, I've already written down it so that I don't waste my time in writing down, the video becomes shorter. So when we talk about the solutions, there are also called as something as the true solutions. Now what are the true solutions? True solutions are those solutions in which the size of the solute particles is very, very less, very small. When the size of the solutions are what? Solute plus solvent. So when the size of the solute particle is very small, how much small? That is 10 raised to minus 10. Otherwise also, suppose if you take any solution, if you are taking a sugar solution, there is sugar in water, in that solution, can you see the sugar particles once the solution has been formed? Can you see that? No. Or suppose if you take a salt solution, there is salt mixed in water, where water is acting as a solvent and the salt is acting as a solute. Can you see the salt particles separately in water? No. Why we cannot see? Because the particles of the solute are very, very less. So such type of solutions where the particle size of the solute is very, very less. How much less? That is 10 raised to minus 10 meters. So you just imagine 10 raised to minus 10, how small it is. So solutions in which the size of the solute particles is very less, that is 10 raised to minus 10 meters, such type of solutions, we call them as true solutions. Now we come to the characteristics of the true solutions. True solutions are homogeneous mixtures. Homogeneous mixtures means what? They will be like, the phase will be same. If in this type of, I gave you an example of sugar solution or your salt solution, you will not be able to identify the sugar particles in water, nor you will be able to identify the salt particles present in water. So it is like homogeneous, very like uniformly distributed. We can say when the solute particles are uniformly distributed throughout the solvent, such a mixture, we call this as homogeneous mixture. So we can over here, we can just write down over here, uniform distribution. If we say what is a homogeneous mixture, that is uniform distribution of solute in solvent, that is you won't be able to identify which is the, where is the solute, where is the solvent. At the same time, if you just divide a true solution, let us take the example of the sugar solution. You take that sugar solution and divide into 5 equal parts. All the parts will be giving you the same sweetness. Or a salt solution, you divide into 5 equal parts. All the parts of the solution will be equally salty. That means equally the solute particles have got dissolved into the solvent. So such a type of solution, we call that as a true solution. So they are homogeneous mixtures. The size of the solute particles is very small. That is 10 raised to minus 10 meters. They do not scatter light. Now what does it mean? That is, they do not scatter light. Suppose now this is this effect of scattering of light that is called as the Tyndall effect. Now this has been shown by solutions which has got the solute particles slightly bigger in size, that is the colloidal solutions. We don't have in the syllabus colloidal solutions, so I'll not go much in detail, but just I'm giving an example over here. Suppose if you are having a container and you are taking any colloidal solution into it and you make a light to pass through it, we'll find that this light will get scattered in the form of a cone. Now this is a beaker made up of glass. The light will get scattered in the form of a cone. Now this effect, we call this as a Tyndall effect, that is scattering of light. Okay, so the solutions which show this Tyndall effect, that is the, we can say this scattering of light, that is called as a Tyndall effect. So these two solutions, they will not scatter light, that means they are not going to show any Tyndall effect. But at the same time, look over here, that is these components, they are very, this solid particles are very small in size. So obviously we cannot separate those solute as well as the solvent by the process of filtration. If you take a proper, if you take your ordinary filter and you try to separate sugar from water, you will not be able to separate out because the components are very small. That is, this sugar particles are very small in size and cannot be separated by filtration. At the same time, the solution will be clear and transparent. And the particle size is very less because the particles are very small. We'll find that the solution, solute particles, they do not settle down. It's a like very common phenomenon, that is, if suppose if something is very small in size, the movement will be more. If something is bigger in size, the movement will be very less. You take an example of a person. A person whose weight is very less, small in size and very less, we can say if the mass of the person, that is the weight of the person, is very less, then you will find that the person will be able to walk for a longer time. But on the contrary to this, suppose if a person is very fat, obviously after some time the person is going to get tired. So this is also what happens over here, because the particle size is so less, these particles, they keep on moving continuously within the container. So we can see over here that the solute particles, they do not settle down over here. So I hope this true. So when we talk about the solutions, we talk basically about the, when we talk about the solutions, we actually talk about the true solutions. When we refer to the solutions, we are referring to what? We refer to the true solution. That is the solutions, the mixtures which are having all these characteristics, the mixtures which are having all these characteristics, they are called as the true solutions, and that is what exactly we mean by solutions when we talk about the solutions. Now besides this, there are certain other terms that we know, need to know from this particular chapter, from this particular part. Let's come to all those other terms. That is the aqueous solutions. Now what do we mean by aqueous solutions? The solutions in which the solvent used is water. Those type of solutions where the solvent is water, those type of solutions we call that as a aqueous solutions. On the contrary to this, the solutions where we are not using water as a solvent but some other liquid has been used as a solvent, that can be your petrol, or that can be your alcohol, or any other organic solvent which can be used, that is benzene, those type of solutions where any other solvent that has been used but not water, that is water is not the medium of dissolution, such type of solutions we call them as a non-aqueous solution. So there are various organic compounds which act as a solvent, that is your chloroform, carbon tetrachloride, all these are different types of your organic solvent. So here, if you are using your CCl4, that is carbon tetrachloride, or petrol or alcohol as the solvent, then such type of solutions we call them as a non-aqueous solutions. Okay, so next term that we have is a dilute solution. So dilute solutions are those solutions where the amount of the solute particles are very less. So we can see over here, when the amount of the solute particles are very less, these type of solutions, so when we say amount of solute is less as compared to solvent, such type of solutions we call this as dilute solution. So what are the concentrated solution? Just the opposite of this. That is when the amount of solute is more. When solute is more, I'm just writing it down below it. Solute is more as compared to solvent, then such type of solutions we call them as a concentrated solutions. Okay, I hope it's clear. What are the concentrated solutions? That is when you are having, suppose if you come to the same example of sugar solution. So if amount of sugar is more and water is less, so if sugar is more, so that will be called as a concentrated sugar solution. On the contrary to this, suppose if your sugar is less and water is more, that means sweetness will be less, and so that will be called as a dilute solution. Usually we use these terms not for the general solutions that we use at home, but usually we use it for the acids. Suppose in acid, hydrochloric acid, we mix water into it. So hydrochloric acid acts as a solute and water acts as a solvent. So if your acid is more, okay, if acid will be more as compared to water, so that type of solution we can call that as a concentrated one. But on the contrary to this, if acid is less and water is more, that will be called as the dilute solution. Then we have the saturated solution. Now what is a saturated solution? Okay, a solution, I'm writing down in short, over a solution that cannot dissolve any more of the solute at a given temperature, that solution we call it as a saturated solution. Suppose you are taking water, again the same example, if you take water and you add sugar to it, fine, you dissolve it, you stir it, you dissolve it, again you add some more sugar to it, and let this be kept at a room temperature, at the normal temperature, let it be at a room temperature. So you add more sugar to it, you dissolve it, fine, and you keep on adding one spoon or two spoons of sugar at the same temperature into the water until a stage will come when it will not, that water will not be able to dissolve any more of the sugar into it. So such a solution which has been formed, into which no more solute can dissolve at that particular temperature, that is called as the saturated solution. We can say the solution has become saturated. Like suppose if you study too much of your, suppose every day, suppose it happens that in a day you are having all 7 chemistry classes. What will happen? I will keep on teaching for
suppose one period somehow you will, one period that's normal, every day you have one or two periods, one period chemistry fine, two period also fine, then again the other teacher is absent, I come as a substitution, third period also okay. From fourth period what will happen, whatever that I will teach, even if I will teach the easiest concept, you will, that will stop going inside your brain. That means that is a stage when you are already saturated with chemistry. You will not be able to take any more of the chemistry at that particular time. That means you have been saturated with the knowledge of chemistry and no more of the chemistry knowledge can be taken on that particular day. Clear? So in the same way also, in the solution also, that is, you are adding solute to it. At that particular temperature, you go on adding more solute to it. Again and again you go on adding. Then a stage will come when that water will not be able to take up any more of the solute. So such a solution, we call that as a saturated solution. I hope at the present moment you are not saturated with the chemistry. We can proceed further for some few more minutes over here. You are unsaturated till now. So let's proceed further. So how to prepare a saturated solution? What you do is, you take 100 ml of water. So let's take for example, in a beaker you take 100 ml of water. Okay, and to that you add 1 spoon, or let us take, let us, you take 1 gram of nitre. Either you add nitre or you can also add copper sulfate to it. Any, suppose if you want to make a solution or saturated solution of copper sulfate, you add copper sulfate to it. If you want to make a saturated solution of nitre, you take nitre over here. Now when we take, I'm just for the example I'm telling you 100 ml, but when we talk about this process of solubility of a solute in solvent, that is how much a substance that is soluble in a particular, that is 100 grams of the solvent, we call that term as a solubility, which we'll be discussing over here later on. So for the sake of simplicity, you can take 100 ml, or you can just, because it has been defined on the basis of grams, let us take this as 100 grams of water, and you add 1 gram of nitre to it. Okay, you dissolve it, you stir it, you will find that it will get dissolved. After some time, again you keep, you add 1 gram of nitre, or you, if you are taking copper sulfate, you can take copper sulfate, any one of the component can be taken. You again dissolve, stir it, dissolve, again you add 1 gram of nitre at the same temperature, again 1 gram of nitre, and let the temperature at same temperature, that is, don't heat this solution which is being made, no heat is to be supplied to this solution. After some time this will become saturated, that means it will not, again if you add 1 gram of nitre to it, you will find that it is, no, the nitre will remain undissolved into it. So such a solution into which no more of the solute that can dissolve at a given temperature, a solution that cannot dissolve any more of the solute at a given temperature, such a solution we call that as saturated solution. But on the contrary to this, a solution which can dissolve more of the solute at that particular temperature is called as an unsaturated solution. Like I gave an example of you people having all the 7 classes as chemistry classes, you become saturated. But on the, and then if I say, okay, I'm coming to your home also to teach you chemistry as your chemistry teacher, as a tuition teacher, then you will say, no, we don't want any more chemistry. For at least for 3-4 days, you will say a big no, no, no to me or to any of the chemistry teacher. But on the contrary, when you feel like studying more, okay, more you can take up, more you can understand, so you are unsaturated with the knowledge. So in the same way, if a solution is made in such way that it can take more of the solute, it can dissolve more of the solute at that particular temperature, that solution we call that as a unsaturated solution. Okay, now a solution which is, what happens, suppose if a solution, that is the saturated solution, that has been cooled. Now as the temperature goes down, that is, as the temperature decreases, what happens to the solubility? As the temperature decreases, I'll just showing it with an arrow, solubility will also decrease. So if this saturated solution, if you allow it to cool down, you are bringing the temperature down. Okay, if this temperature, you are cooling the saturated solution, you are decreasing the solubility, and you leave this solution undisturbed for some time in an open area, you will find that the solvent, that is suppose if you are having a saturated solution of copper sulfate or you are having a saturated solution of nitre, let's take you are having a saturated solution of copper sulfate, you will get the crystals of copper sulfate. And this whole process where you get a crystals of a particular solid from the saturated solution, this process we call it as a process of crystallization. So different solids, they have a different crystal structure. There are various solids, and various solids, they have got the different solids will be having the different crystal structure. Here the crystal, that is the shape of the crystal of copper sulfate, is rhombotric. In the same way, various other crystals, they may have some, suppose if your solid is something different, then the structure of the crystal will be something different. Now let me show you certain crystal structures. So these are certain crystal structure. You can see this first structure, this is cubic in shape. So sodium chloride will have a crystal structure of cubic shape. That is, sodium chloride crystal is cubic as a shape, in shape. Similarly, the next structure, this is rhombotric. As I explained you just some time back, I told you about copper sulfate. So copper sulfate crystals, they have this shape, this structure, which is called as rhombotric. Then next we are having this structure, which is called as the octahedral. Now octahedral, that means your certain substances such as ferrous sulfate will have the structure, that is will have the shape of a octahedral. The next is over here, there is prismatic. So certain substances such as your potassium nitrate, that will be having the shape of this particular shape, which is called as prismatic. So you can see different substances, different crystals. When you take different types of solids and when you induce them to the process of crystallization, when you subject it to the process of crystallization, you will be getting different type of crystals. Those may be having the different shapes depending on the substance that you take. So this process is called as crystallization. Now look here, we can do this lecture, just go in detail about how this process it can be done. Let me rub the board over here. Let us take, suppose this is the petri dish or any container we take over here, into this a saturated solution of copper sulfate, that is water. Into water we add copper sulfate in more quantity, that is you go on adding copper sulfate until you get a saturated solution. So this is a saturated solution of copper sulfate, and we maintain a particular temperature, that is this solution that has been prepared at 80 degree Celsius. You heat heat the water, you bring it to 80 degree Celsius, and then you add copper sulfate to it. So you'll be getting a saturated solution of copper sulfate. Now you allow this, so these are having some crystals of copper sulfate which have got dissolved, which are not able to see. You allow this solution to cool down, and you will find this solution, let it be there undisturbed for some few hours or probably for a day. You will find after some time, or after a day, or maybe after some few hours, some 7 to 8 hours, you will find some crystals of copper sulfate will be appearing at the top. Let me represent it with some red pen over here. So some crystals of copper sulfate. Now these crystals, they are very small, I cannot show it in a proper crystal structure. Just assume that some crystals of copper sulfate will be formed over here. So these are some crystals of copper sulfate that has been formed over here. Okay, now next what you do is, you take another beaker, let us take another beaker. Now this beaker, you fill it with again saturated solution of copper sulfate. Let this also contain a saturated solution of copper sulfate. So this has been filled with a saturated solution, I am writing down in short, solution of
copper sulfate. And let the temperature be room temperature, so you need not heat it up to 80 degrees Celsius as we have done over here. Let the temperature be room temperature, your normal temperature. And what you do is, you take one crystal of copper sulfate from this particular container. Okay? And after that, you cover it with a piece of paper, or if not paper will not be wise to say, you can cover it with a cardboard or any cover. The cover should be such that you should be able to pierce it from the center. So cardboard is a better option, although in the books you will find that it has to be covered with the paper. But paper is very, it is not very stiff, so it will move away with the wind. So the better option is a cardboard. You take a cardboard, you cover it with a cardboard, and at the center of this cardboard you make an opening. So let there be an opening in the center, and through an opening you suspend a thread. Okay, so thread has been suspended. To this thread, what you will be doing is, you will be tying one crystal of copper sulfate from this container. That is, you will take one crystal of copper sulfate from this particular container and you suspend it. Clear? And let this be kept covered for some 2-3 days. You will find that after a day or two, that is, this crystal, the original crystal which you have introduced, original crystal of copper sulfate which you have introduced from this container, this crystal starts growing up. That means this crystal becomes bigger and bigger in size. Now what exactly is happening? This solution is already saturated with copper sulfate. So when this one crystal of copper sulfate is introduced over here, more copper sulfate from the side starts gathering towards this. Okay, they deposit on this, making this small crystal of copper sulfate bigger in size. So what are we doing over here? That from here also we are getting the crystals of copper sulfate, that is from this particular solution. That means we are making this, inducing this process of crystallization. So this process of, the process of inducing crystallization, this process, we call this process as seeding. And this original crystal that we take over here, we suspend it over here, this crystal, we call this as the seed crystal. This is called as the seed crystal. Seed crystal of copper sulfate. Clear? That is, you take one crystal, you are suspending into it, that is called as a seed crystal. And this process of inducing crystallization, or the crystallization has already been induced, in order to speed up the process, in order to make it more effective and better, you are inducing into a saturated solution of copper sulfate which is at the room temperature. We call this process, the whole process, as the process of seeding. So don't get confused between crystallization and seeding. This process, up till here it is crystallization, but when you are making it more better, when you are inducing crystallization, that is in this another solution also, the crystallization should start. This process, and because you are starting with a seed crystal, the process, we call this as a process of seeding. Clear? Now as we are studying about solutions, formation of solutions, solvent, solute, the solute has to be soluble in a solvent for the formation of a saturated solution, and so on. We should be first be clear with the idea, what exactly do we mean by solubility. So we move on to our next, we'll move on to the next term, that is solubility. But before solubility, I missed out one thing, that is the supersaturated solution. What is a supersaturated solution? Supersaturated solution. So we already know what is a saturated solution. The solution which cannot hold any more of the solute at a given temperature, that is called as a saturated solution. Supersaturated means what? It is even more saturated. So we can say a solution which has got more amount of the solute. So solution having more amount of the solute. Solution having more amount of the solute. That is called as the super saturated solution. The solution I have written down in short, so don't get confused over here. So solution having more amount of the solute at a particular temperature, that is called as the super saturated solution. How would you prepare a super saturated solution? First of all, you prepare a saturated solution by adding more amount of the solid to the solvent. You keep on adding, you keep on stirring it, you prepare it. So by adding more and more, a time will come when more of the solute will stop getting dissolved into the solvent, and we will say that the solvent has got saturated with the solute. You get a saturated solution. Once you get a saturated solution, you take this saturated solution. Let me change my pen. This has become lighter. So you take a saturated solution. And you heat it. That means you increase the temperature. As you increase the temperature, as you heat it, now this solution will be capable of taking more of the solute. Because the temperature is increased, and we know that with the increase in temperature, the solute will be dissolving more and more into it. So we'll find with the increase in temperature, this saturated solution will be capable of taking more of the solute. So after increasing the temperature, you add more solute. So this solution which we get over here, this is a super saturated solution. I can give you this example in the terms of chemistry. That is, suppose when you are already saturated with the knowledge of chemistry, suppose after you have 3 classes of chemistry in a day, you become saturated with the knowledge of chemistry. Now then, once you become saturated, you don't want to learn any more chemistry on that particular day. But suppose again, if I'm been forced to come to your class, obviously by the management, then what I will be doing is that, okay, I'll start with the class with some jokes and all. I'll crack some jokes, we'll have a good time pass, we'll have some games in the class. So once, after doing that, your brain will be once more very much fresh. You'll be very happy. Then you will be thinking, oh, after this, then if the chemistry teacher is going, it is a maths teacher who is going to come, and that will be even more dreadful. So while not, let's have chemistry teacher only as it is, she has cracked so many jokes, we had so much of entertainment and fun. And then when you are more ready to take up more of the chemistry knowledge at that particular instant than it was required by you, then that you can call the situation that you have been super saturated with the knowledge of chemistry. So here when we are talking about the solutions, we can say that the solution has been super saturated with a particular solute. That solute can be a potassium nitrate, that solute can be your sodium chloride, or that solute can be your copper sulfate. Okay. So when we are talking about the solute and the solvent, one more important term that we need to know over here, and that important term is the solubility. Now what do we mean by solubility? Solubility. So first of all, let us define what do we mean by solubility. Now, when we talk about a particular term, obviously we are dealing over here with the solute and the solvent. So the amount of the solvent, because we have to define it now, the amount of the solvent that we have to take it in grams over here. So we can say the amount of the solute that can be dissolved, in a particular solvent, in 100 grams of the solvent to form a saturated solution at a particular temperature. That is what we call it as solubility. Now let us see what does it exactly means over here. Suppose if you are having, let us take a container. And into this we are taking, let the water that we take over here be 100 grams. So as I already said, when we refer to this definition, we have to take the amount of the solvent in grams. So let the amount of water over here be, let it be water. So this is our water and this is 100 grams of water. We want to make a solution with sodium chloride. So we have to add some sodium chloride to it. So we'll be adding some sodium chloride to it. So let me represent it with another pen, another color pen over here. So we are adding some sodium chloride to it in order to make it saturated. Okay, some crystals of sodium chloride, that is a cubic crystals. Basically, you cannot see with your eyes that the crystals are cubic in shape. So we are adding some sodium chloride, that is NaCl, and let the temperature will maintain at 40 degrees Celsius. 40 degrees Celsius. Now this, in order to saturate, in order to make a saturated solution of sodium chloride at 40 degrees Celsius, we will be needing around about 36.5 grams. So we'll need over here 36.5 grams of sodium chloride. How much of sodium chloride that is required over here? That is 36.5 grams. Okay, so we can say now, we can, so that means if you are adding 36.5 grams of sodium chloride to 100 grams of water at 40 degrees Celsius, we will be getting a saturated solution of sodium chloride over here. So we can say 36.5 grams of sodium chloride dissolves in 100 grams of water at 40 degrees Celsius to form a saturated solution. And 36.5 grams, that's a very good solubility. So we can say sodium chloride is highly soluble, that is common salt is highly soluble in water. This is highly soluble, very much soluble in water. Okay, that is, I repeat once again, that the solubility of sodium chloride is 36.5 grams at 40 degrees Celsius. If I say this, that is solubility of sodium chloride is 36.5 grams at 40 degrees Celsius, it means that 36.5 grams of sodium chloride can be dissolved in 100 grams of water at 40 degrees Celsius. So even if I am not mentioning the amount of the solvent, solubility refers to the 100 grams of the solvent. Even if a person does not refer to the name of the solvent, we always consider that is even if we don't refer to the amount of the solvent, it has always been considered as the 100 gram. And most of the time the solutions, they have been prepared in water. So when we talk about solutions, we talk about the solubility in water, that is 100 grams of water. So we can say over here that is solubility, the amount of solute that can dissolve in 100 grams of the solvent at a particular temperature to form a saturated solution, that is called as the solubility. I hope this term is clear to you. Let us take another example. Suppose you take another container. Let me draw this another example with another color. So this is another container. All right. And into this container, again we are taking our same solvent. Why we are taking water every time? Because we are studying about water. The chapter is what? Water. And it is a very important solvent. It is a universal solvent which can dissolve almost everything. And otherwise also, whenever we talk about solubility, we refer to water only as the solvent. That is 100 grams of water. And we are taking over here again 100 grams of water. Okay, and to this, so water is over here 100 grams and we want to make a solution of potassium nitrate. So we have to add potassium nitrate. So how will we show this with another color? Let me show it over here with black color. I've added potassium nitrate crystals over here. Okay, so what is the potassium nitrate? There is the crystals are prismatic. These are prismatic. What about sodium chloride? This was cubic. Okay, so we are adding potassium nitrate crystals over here, and in order to make this solution saturated with potassium nitrate, how much of the potassium nitrate is required? We require it, that is 65 grams. We require 65 grams of potassium nitrate. So I'll write down over here, that is 65 grams of potassium nitrate is required in order to make a saturated solution at the same temperature, that is at 40 degree Celsius. So we can say now the solubility of potassium nitrate is 65 grams of 40 degree Celsius. It means what? Potassium nitrate, that 65 grams of potassium nitrate is required in 100 grams of water at 40 degree Celsius in order to make a saturated solution. Clear? So this is what it means by solubility. We talk so much about solubility, you know, but what exactly is solubility? That we should be knowing. Now there are, it's not that all the salts are equally soluble. Certain salts are very much soluble, certain salts are less soluble, certain salts are too much soluble. So let us see the different criteria of this term, that is solubility. Let me first rub it off. Let us take certain examples. Let us take the example of silver chloride. Now silver chloride, that is 0.000015 grams, is soluble. If I say that the solubility of silver chloride is 0.00015, so it means what? That in 100 grams of water, 100 grams of water at room temperature is capable to dissolve only this much of silver chloride. So this much means it is how much? That is 15 into 10 raised to minus 6 gram. That is a very less quantity. 15 into 10 raised to minus 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 15 into 10 raised to minus 6. That is a very less quantity. So the solubility of such a salt, that solubility of silver chloride is very less, or we can say it's negligible. So we call this solubility as a negligible solubility. Such a less solubility, we call this as negligible solubility. We take another example. Suppose certain salts, certain substances which are more soluble than negligible, which are having more solubility, that is more than negligible solubility, but less than high solubility. See, sodium chloride, potassium nitrate, all they are having the high solubility. So something, any salt which is having less than high solubility, less than high solubility and more than negligible solubility. Such a solubility we call this as, or such salts we call this as sparingly soluble, and such substances are showing sparingly solubility, or we can say such salts are sparingly soluble. Sparingly soluble, or we can say the solubility is sparingly, there is a sparingly solubility. Okay. So here, look here, let us have an example of such a substance having a sparingly solubility, or which is sparingly soluble, that is calcium hydroxide. Calcium hydroxide, if you want to make a solution of calcium hydroxide in water, calcium hydroxide is 0.17 grams soluble in water. That means calcium hydroxide is 0.17 grams is soluble in 100 grams of water at the room temperature. So such a solubility, so we can call this as, so 0.17 is also not too much, but it is more than this and less, so it is more than this, it is more than negligible solubility but less than high solubility. So we call this salt, that is calcium hydroxide, is sparingly soluble. Clear? So when we talk about solubility, there are very, so I hope this term is very much clear. What do we mean by high solubility or sparingly soluble and negligible solubility? Now negligible solubility, we can also call it as insoluble. Such type of substances can be called as insoluble because they are near to the
negligible solubility. Solubility is extremely very less, so it can be called as a insoluble. Okay. Now there are certain factors on which this solubility is dependent. Solubility can be increased, solubility can be decreased. There are several factors on which the solubility depends. So let us just see those factors, that is factors affecting solubility. Factors affecting solubility. Now what are those factors? How that solubility depends on what factors? So certain factors, first of all, size of the solute particles. Size of the solute particles. Or size of the solute. Okay, now this is very common, obviously. If the size of the solute is very less, very small solute particles will find that the solute will be able to dissolve into the solvent, the solubility will be more. If the solute particle is big, if the solutes are bigger in size, particles of the solute are too much big in size, will find it will be difficult to be getting dissolved into the solvent. So in order to make the better solution, in order to increase the solubility, what can we do? You can break those solute particles into smaller pieces and you can dissolve into the solvent. So size of the solute particles. Next is what? Sterile. That is, by stirring a solute into the solvent, you can increase the solubility. You just imagine you take a glass of water and you add sugar to it. And you keep on standing and you keep on looking at the solution, waiting for the sugar to get dissolved into water, waiting for the sugar solution, that you can have some sweet solution as a sugar syrup for your various purposes. You keep on waiting for it. It will take hours to get dissolved in it. But if you take a spoon and you start stirring it, you will find that sugar will dissolve into the solvent. So stirring is the another factor, that is, if you stir the solution, the process will be faster. Faster you can make a solution. Third is temperature. That is, if temperature is more. Suppose you take, I'll give an example. You want to make a sugar solution and you want to add some that lemon and all for drinking it during the summers. So you take some water from the refrigerator and you add sugar to it, you add lemon to it. Lemon is in the liquid state, so no problem, but the problem is with the dissolution of the sugar particles into the water. So if this water is taken from the refrigerator, which is extremely cold, which is extremely chilled, you will find that sugar crystal, and then you even stir it, you will find it will take a long time to get dissolved. But if you take your normal tap water and you dissolve sugar crystals into it, you will find that it will get dissolved. So we can say with the increase in temperature, solubility also increases. Decrease in temperature solubility, okay, decrease in temperature with a downward arrow, solubility also decreases. Clear? Then there are various other factors. Just some time back I gave you certain examples that a particular salt, silver chloride, is very less soluble. Then on the contrary to this, calcium hydroxide is more soluble, that is sparingly soluble, and silver chloride is negligible soluble, it has a negligible solubility. Or rather, we can call it as insoluble, and whereas sodium chloride and potassium nitrate, they are more soluble. So another factor is also, that is a type of the solute taken. That is type of the solute as well as the type of the solvent. We'll find in certain solvents a particular substance may not be soluble, or a particular substance is such that a particular solute is such that it may not be soluble in your particular solvent. So those are the other factors also which controls the solubility, but these are the three main important factors which I have mentioned over here on which the solubility of a solute depends. Okay students, so we have covered a lot today. So thank you, keep well, and we'll continue further in the next video.